Hi, my name is Taylor Chang, the Doris Duke Theatre Manager, and welcome to the 7th Annual Honolulu Surf Film Festival.
Hello, my name's Abby Algar. I'm the film curator at the Honolulu Museum of Art, and I really want to thank the presenting sponsor of the Honolulu Surf Film Festival, Nordstrom. Thank you so much for supporting the festival again this year. It's awesome.
That we have on stage. I don't know if you've noticed it as you're walking in, but this is a pedal power music bike, and we have La Carvalho, who is the mastermind behind Knowledge in Motion, who created this, who brought this bike to Hawaii. but also making what we're doing possible. So this bike is what it does. It's powering right now this mic, as well as these three mics down here, which we're going to use at the end of the film for the panel discussion.
And of course, thank you. And I know Anna Trent Moore is going to say more about this, but thank you to Mr. Ricky Griggs' friends and family for being here this evening and for sharing Ricky's story and for celebrating surfing with us and celebrating the people that make it great. Thank you. This screening and event would not be happening without the passion and energy of Miss Anna Trent Moore. And Anna is the curator and owner of the Bud Brown Film Archives, which many of you know. And they've shared amazing surf film classics from the father of surf filmmaking for the past 4 years. I think this is the fifth year, actually. And Anna has selected another amazing winner for us this evening in Cavalcade of Surf, which of course features the young Ricky Grigg. And she's also organized a panel, which she's going to tell you about in a moment. So without further ado, it's my pleasure and honor to welcome Anna Trentmore to the stage.
I would like to take this moment to thank Abby Algar for inviting us once again and for the outstanding job she has done this year. Thank you, Abby. I would also like to thank our most special guests who have so graciously decided to be with us in our presence tonight. Ricky Grigg's wife, Maria Grigg. Daughters, Raina and Romy Grigg. Ricky's grandson, Titus. And Ricky's stepson, Mark. Thank you so much for honoring us with your presence this evening. I'd also like to thank our special luminaries of the evening who will lead the panel tribute following the film, the incomparable Mr. Peter Cole. The amazing Kimo Hollinger. The eclectic Mr. Jock Severin. The illustrious Mr. Randy Burrick. Thank you, gentlemen, for being with us tonight. The quest for understanding is eternal. This is perhaps Ricky Grigg's most favorite Einstein quote. He certainly shared it often enough. And even more important, it was the credo by which he lived his life. And indeed, Ricky's quest to understand was to last the duration of his life, up until the very end. He considered himself first and foremost a scientist, though I would often politely disagree with him and remind him otherwise, because in truth, every pursuit in his life led him ultimately to one thing, and that was surfing. From the time as a young boy, catching the wind in a pillowcase, before rushing into the ocean to ride the white water upon it, to eventually evolving into surfing 30-foot waves, to dissecting, discovering, analyzing, and sharing all that he gathered and understood of the sea. Ultimately, all roads led to one thing for Ricky Grigg, and that was his great love of surfing.
Yeah.
Grigg certainly has left such an imprint. Prolifically in his writing, his science, his children, and his friends. Here tonight, it is my privilege to introduce a few that are here to share about the man we all knew and loved, either personally or vicariously. Their friendship survived longer than some lifetimes. Before he died, Ricky told me, and I quote, "Mutt and Jeff we were, Mutt and Jeff, except Peter was just a little taller." Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Peter Cole. Mr. Kimo Hollinger. If you surf big waves on the North Shore, you are part of a brotherhood beyond question. Part of this brotherhood of wave riders and also a friend of Ricky Grigg's, joining us once again, Mr. Jock Sutherland. He was Ricky's neighbor at his beloved Sunset Beach House. But most important of all, he was a friend to him for many years. It gives me great pleasure to bring to the stage tonight the one and only Mr. Randy Rurick.
And Ricky was an amazing person and a very, very good friend. And we had a lot of good times together, surfing and also just being around each other. And I first got to really know Ricky well. I knew Ricky from way back through his sister Robin, who was a little older than Ricky. And I knew Robin was a couple of years behind me in school and at both Lincoln and Samo High and on to Stanford. And then Ricky came a little bit after Robin, and all three of us graduated from Stanford, and I got to know Ricky real well because I was teaching down in San Lorenzo Valley High School in Felton, right above Santa Cruz, and living in Pleasure Point. And Ricky and Bill Bullis, another friend of ours that were Stanford seniors, helped me with my rent and would come down and stay on weekends. And we got a lot of surf together that year, and that's when I got to really know Ricky well. And then the following year, we came to Hawaii. And that was an experience to be, the first time we went out at sunset, it was about 4 feet at the point, and then it gradually got bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it was about 10 foot in the middle. And we didn't know what we were doing. We didn't know where the lineup was or anything else, but it was really fun. And then one really good day, George Downing and Wally Forsythe and a bunch of guys were out, and we were on this, Ricky was on a Velzy bump board and I was on a Sweet Robinson board, and both those boards used to spin out at Malibu, and at sunset they were really ridiculous. And I had 19 swims and Ricky had 17 swims. But it's been a good long time. The second year I was in the islands, we moved up to Lanahuli Street right above Punahou. And I had as housemates or roommates, whatever you want to call it. And we had Fred Van Dyke and Ricky and myself. And poor Jim Blatto just graduated from high school and moved in with these three demented old men. And we had a good time in that house. And one of the things that I really enjoyed was the year before at the Makaha contest, Ricky got fourth and I got first. And Ricky never forgot that. He just complained. He said, "Oh, the judges, and I was by far the best rider out there, and whoa. So when we were at the Lanahuli's house, I put my trophy right above his bed. And Ricky, I would come home from work. I was teaching at Punahou, and I'd come home, and my board would be in the garbage can. I'd pick the thing up and put it over his head. And then Jim and Fred got the idea too, and they would put it over his head if I wasn't around. Poor Ricky finally gave up and had that board over his head for the whole year, and I just really enjoyed that. But what we thought we'd do is each of us would say something about Ricky and about the film and about the tremendous films that Bud Brown produced. And then after we each said something, I thought we could open it up for questions from the audience and to any one of us, and we'll have a good long, not long, but Kimo has to get to bed. Kimo, would you like to say something?
Pokey Bauer and I we crashed a party that Rick and his friends were having at Cabela Bay. And then Rick must have just come back from Tahiti because he was doing the tamari.
That's great. Yeah, Rick was really a good Tahitian dancer.
And Peter and Fred didn't mind the pigeon, but Ricky didn't like us talking all that pigeon, and then Paul and I were talking pigeon, and then these two cute Holly girls came, and then we ditched that and went to our Punahou English. So then, at the end of the party, then Rick said, he winked at me and he said, "Gee, Kimo, I didn't know you know how to speak English." I thought to myself, I said, "Hey, man, you're ragging on me. How about you chasing all those pretty Oriental girls?" And then another time, we were going to surf Waimea. It was beautiful. You know, the waves were big and thin, and we could catch them. And then these guys on this boat came out, and they told us we couldn't surf because there was going to be a contest. So I was stunned, you know, that they wouldn't let us surf. And Jose almost got into it with the guys on the boat, but because I worked for the county, I was a fireman, I figured I'd get in more trouble if I tried to do something like that. So I just paddled way out and I just sat there and sulked. And then the contest started and here comes Ricky. He's coming back. I thought we weren't going to surf, but he had designated himself to be the contest lifeguard. And he was catching all the waves. Okay. This is the last one, the third one. My friends and I were surfing outside Wailua, and I caught a wave, and when I get off the wave, this whale breached. And it was a killer whale, it was an orca. Because my daughter lives in San Diego and she took me to SeaWorld to see Shamu. So I knew it was an orca. So when I paddled out, I told all those guys, "Hey man, I saw an orca, it breached." And you know, they said, "Nah," they didn't believe me. And then I looked far out, and I saw the big mama whale going and the little baby whale right behind. So I figured to myself, that's why the orcas are there, you know, to get the baby whale. And I was excited. When I went home, I was still excited. So I looked in the phone book and I got Rick's number and I called him. And he said, and you know, he kind of looked like Professor Grigg. "Kimo, that's impossible. It would be more likely that would happen than if you woke up early in the morning and found an elephant in your backyard."
These are the gentlemen, along with Jose Angel, Fred Van Dyke, and Wally Price of George Downing, West Akaki, Mr. Mom, is it Herman Mom or Henry?
Henry.
Thank you. But these are the guys who, if you were lucky enough, got to show you the lineup, especially if they knew your folks, you know, that Grigg and all them. They'd show you the lineup, and then, you know, if you wiped out, you might get your board. But back then, we were all swimmers because there was no leashes, and so that it led to a spirit of sportsmanship. But Ricky was part of the older contingent. But one of the things that I remember about Ricky when we were at the World Contest in 66 in San Diego was that, and he was already an established scientist by then, he said, yeah, looks like there's going to be a nice swell, 3, 4, or 5 feet coming in for you guys. And we're going, how can you tell this? You know, and this is the early days of prediction, surf prediction. But this was part of Ricky's mystique to us younger guys. But he was older, but he was a good surfer, but he was established in the surfing community. But he, because of surfing's early image as perhaps being not so admirable as it is today, you know, we were changing, you know, in public, and, you know, doing things that were not regarded as, shall we say, genteel. But Ricky was one of the guys who was a suit and tie. He was an established scientist, and he was one of the first guys to give surfing a respectable, if you will, image. But you know, if you're a surfer, you didn't really care about image, but it was to the sports credit that Ricky was able to do the things that he did. But like I say, he was one of the older, established guys who was already, you know, a good waterman, good diver, good surfer. And we, you know, looked up to him as an uncle or an older brother, and it was really my pleasure to have known him.
Well, as Jock said, that he and I are from the next generation behind Ricky, and I grew up in the South Shore, and then when I got out of high school, I moved to the North Shore. And Fred Van Dyke, he actually hired me to go to work on the old Duke Classic, as to be kind of a runner, and my job was to just kind of be a gopher guy. And I actually still have the paycheck stub from that. I made a whopping $17 for working on the Duke Classic. But I also started off really early in the industry, and I got a job working at Charlie Galeno's Grigg Knowles shop. And Grigg was sponsoring Peter and Kimo and all the big wave riders. And Ricky, he had this board in 1966, and it was going into 67 and the Duke Classic. In those days, they were going to wait for the really good surf. And so actually it was the 66 contest, but it didn't get held until I think late January, early February of 67. So Ricky brought this board into Charlie Galeno's Grigg Knowles shop, and I was the ding repair guy there. And he says, Randy, okay, you gotta do something to the fin of this board to make me go faster than Peter's boards. and I remember that. I was like 16, I was going, really? Is it that big of a deal? He goes, for sure, I've gotta go faster than Peter. And Ricky went on to win the Duke Classic that year, and I don't know what happened to Peter. I think Peter was in it that year, but no, that was the second year.
I didn't get nominated.
Yeah. But then, so he was happy that at least he got to go faster than Peter at some point.
Oh, yeah.
And then I must say the next year, it was actually 67, 68 season, Jock went on to win the Duke Classic from that one. So good for you, Jock. Ricky and I lived next door to each other for over 20 years at Sunset Beach, and as Jock said, Peter, Kimo, and Ricky, of course, were kind of our inspiration to surf Sunset. And I always said, well, I want to grow up to be like Ricky because he surfed Sunset. And I made it a point to find a house at Sunset so I could surf Sunset with Ricky. And it was 2 doors away from Ricky, and we're neighbors from that. And I'm still in the same house 37 years later and still surfing Sunset. And I'm up there in spirit with Ricky, for sure.
My name is John DePaul. I've been surfing since 1957. And we all had to learn how to swim before we started surfing. My mom said, you're not going to go into the water unless, you know, near the beach, unless you know how to swim. So we had a place. Well, with the machinery we have today, you know, for getting into the waves, I'm just asking, and this is a general question for the four of you. In your youth, in your prime, would you be going for the really huge waves of riding now?
I think we've got to understand that there is a lot of exaggeration in the past, and they say, the saying is that the older we get, the better we were. And, but, I think really the paddling into the wave, riding big waves, the paddling into the wave is the toughest part. Once you're standing up and you're going to the bottom of the wave, it's really the hard part is over. And as you get older, the one thing you notice is that it gets harder to get up as you get older. There's a full circle in surfing. You start off a kook, you end up a kook. I think being towed in is kind of almost, it's going to cause you to get much, much bigger waves. Now they're trying to paddle in to really big waves. They're using oxygen and things like that. I have no idea what our generation would do, but I know one thing, we didn't have leashes, so we swam a lot. So as far as swimming goes, most of us all could swim. Timo, what's your thoughts on that?
We didn't get paid nothing. Those guys make good money, you know, and that's how they support their families, by riding those waves, you know. And, you know, I hope the best for all of those guys, you know, they deserve it.
We had the definite respect for the ocean, because most of us were divers, you know, not having big incomes, you know, we supplemented the larder by going diving. But we also had respect for, because our equipment in the early days was a lot less capable of handling a bigger wave easily, that, you know, we would sometimes back out of a wave that, you know, we might not think we had a good chance of making. But because of the guys nowadays, they're building on what went before, you know, from our era and then from these gentlemen's era before us, that they have an idea of what they can do, and they're cross training and their diet and their equipment, you know, is a lot better. And so I would say, in direct relation to your question, that yeah, probably a lot of waves, you know, 30 or 40 foot, you know, jaws wave, we would not be paddling into, no.
Well, I deal with all the contemporary pro surfers today, and I can tell you, they would drool to ride waves like these guys rode in their day.
We're obsolete.
I was noticing in this book that Doc Ball did, and a lot of the footage from the past, that it seemed like everybody was riding waves together.
Yes.
Like nowadays, it's like you cannot take off in front of somebody or with somebody. Was there a change, or what? Guys just ride together for fun?
Well, ever since I was surfing, I started in 1944, the guy on the inside had the right of way, and you didn't, if it was a really good wave and he had a real good wall to it, we didn't take off on his outside. But if it's just a kind of a San Onofre type wave or a Palos Verdes type wave, or a, you know, it depended on the wave, but you're supposed to ride. I always thought that riding by myself was a lot more fun than riding with someone else, because you could make motion of the whole wave. And but you know, if you look at the old footage of YMA, there were a lot of guys on those waves, and it was a little bit crowded. I'm amazed that we had crowds in those days, but I'm glad I'm as old as I am, because I had the best of it. We had days at Malibu with two or three of us out, so that was wonderful.
Jungle rules, survival of the fittest.
Like, as unfortunately has happened, that some of us have gone out in the water, and as Ricky did, I heard at Waimea, and some of the younger guys who didn't know him from Adam and didn't really care if he had done, you know, remarkable and fantastic things in his younger years, and so they were shouting at him, you know, to get out of the way, you know, you old coot, that kind of stuff. But to me, it's tragic, you know. But there's a lot of younger guys that do have the sense, you know, of tradition and what's gone before, to be deferential, to, you know, actually, you know, call the guy, call the older guy into it, you know, go, you know, it's happened to me a pipe, you know, go, John, go, then, you know, so you want, yeah, you know, you know, at least, you know, you've had that feeling when you need to take it off, but it will happen. Phil Edwards, I think, had it happen to him, that guys would start calling him, you old kook, and so, you know, if you've been used to having, you know, you pick up the wave so much, but, you know, having a good time out there, and then, with the young pup sharks out there that don't know you from Adam, you know, just nipping at your heels, that can be pretty deflating, you know, to your ego. But you just have to try to do as well as you can, you know, and try to anticipate that time when you might lose a step.
Last year, February, sunset was about 10 feet, and it was a weekend day, so it was really, really crowded. And Ricky came out to go surf the North Shore. Sunset is his favorite spot and where he lived. And so he came and I was there and it was super packed. There was like 75 guys out of Sunset. So I said, Ricky, let's go back down the line and we'll paddle out at a different spot. So we went back down near Himalayas and John Wade, the pilot from Hawaiian Airlines, myself, Ricky, and one other guy paddled out to this outer break. And it was about 8-10 feet, really clean. And we'd left Sunset with 75 guys. We're out there with the three of us and one other guy that happened to be out on a stand-up paddleboard. And we surfed for about 2 hours. And Ricky said, you know, Randy, he says, I love Sunset. It's my favorite wave in the world. But he says, it sure is nice when you're out here only with your friends. So I think the point is, Peter said, being out there with Ricky was probably one of the last sessions I'd had with him on the North Shore, and he just had a wonderful time surfing by with just some friends. So if you can get it with your friends, it's certainly a lot better than get it with a lot of crowd.
Peter, you and Mogi were a great comedy team in that.
That's Paul Gabara, by the way.
Oh, that's my question.
Yeah. Paul Gabara and Kimo Hollinger. I used to drive, I had this kindergarten truck that I bought from Fred for $75. And I would drive out and Kimo and Paul would join me and they'd be doing this Keepy August slack, you know, full on Hawaiian, my brain, pigeon. God, I couldn't even think of it. And they used to make me laugh so hard I was a danger on the highway. But that was Paul Gabara. He was classy. Paul Gabara was a really great guy, great funny guy. I mean, he was hysterical, and it was really fun because Kimo and Paul and Sammy Lee, they were all really good friends, and it was fun to see these guys younger than us doing so well and so enjoyable, you know. So that was fun times.
I was raised in Pearl City, and we used to rule Barbers Point. Now, there's so many chicks out there surfing that they're ruling.
This is true. There's some there's some pretty capable women out there, and some of them are not reluctant to say, hey, get out of my way, old man. I encourage people that it looks like they're having a harder time. You know, sometimes a girl will be on too small of a board or something, so I'll say, hey, you know, do you mind if I push you in or come on over here in the lineup a little bit? And it goes back to the old days when you helped somebody else get their board. And so, like Betty was talking about, people, you know, being discouraged from riding another wave. But if you know somebody that rides a wave, you know their style well enough, like my son Gavin or my other son Maddie here, that you can ride with them. And sometimes, like my brother and I were on a wave at Laniakea, and my son Gavin is on a smaller board, so he's on the inside. It's like 8 or 10 foot wave at Laniakea. And so Gavin takes off with us, and so all three of us are riding this wave. But because we know how the other guy is going to turn, it can be done. But I figured, well, Gavin and James, they got this wave, so I go to pull out, and I almost skull Gavin with my board.
You know, it's funny you're talking about pidgin, and I like to think that if you're from Hawaii and if you're local, you can talk pidgin. But if you're from the mainland, don't try it.
Just wondering if Ricky left any
Maria would know. I think he had a lot of boards over the years. I think he had a Pat Curran board that was real good. Brewer made him some boards. I think Greg Noah made him boards. I think he probably over the years had lots of boards.
One thing that was really interesting about Ricky, he, as Peter said, over the years, he had all the best shaper-shaped boards from him because he was such a good surfer. But he wanted to be completely contemporary, and so he would trade up his boards all the time. And I actually restored about four of Ricky's boards in the last 5 or 6 years. And he says, Randy, I don't want to keep all those old boards. I want to ride what's happening now. So the quiver that he was riding just in the last year was as contemporary as you get. So he always kept up to date with his boards.
He also used a leash.
I want to know if maybe you guys know the perspective from Rick, and I also would like to know your perspective about the essence of surfing. Like, it seems like surfing is so popular that it kind of lost a little bit of its core.
We have such a population increase in the surfing lineup, you know? But I think there's still the camaraderie and there's still the feeling and spirit now that we had back then. I think the biggest difference, I think, is just you have more, and they're doing, I mean, these surfers now, every sport, you know, track, swimming, football, basketball, whatever it is, every generation is much better than the previous generation. And what you see right now, I watch that 1250 on the TV, and I'm just amazed at how these guys surf. I mean, they're just unbelievable. But, you know, back in the old days, it was the same thing. We still had the guys we thought were the best. When I was beginning in the 40s and going through the 50s, to me, the Kelly Slater of those days was Matt Kiblin, who just passed away last March. And Matt Kiblin was just an unbelievably good surfer back in those days, and Mickey Dora worshipped him and copied him. His Mickey Dora style was like Matt. So over the years, you have these different generations, different idols, different this, different that. But I think the surfing is the same now as it was then. It's just more people, more lineups, more technology, more everything. But it's still a camaraderie. You're out in the lineup, you still have that same camaraderie that we had in the old days. And I just think it's just population increase.
I surfed with Ricky about 15 years. He never gave me a wave. You know, what Ricky went through and how he did it, it was just profound. He faced some hard things, but he always had a smile, you know? And to me, he was very brave. Thank you.
He did have a singularity of focus that perhaps ruled out letting other guys have waves. Ricky was, you know, he might have been a little bit different sometimes.
He's a wave hog.
he nonetheless had the ability to be humbled by a big wipeout. Or he also, you know, he really wasn't that much prone to thumping his chest. And then he would raise his hands up, you know, like Greg Noll would wear his singular, his little colorful shorts. And Mark Cunningham back there wanted to know, and maybe you, Kimo, or Peter would know this, was it Conrad Connor that invented the striped shorts, and then maybe Greg followed suit after that, or what?
You know, I really don't know. Conrad didn't know that Greg Noll was going to copy him, but or he would have worn some other type of trunks. No, I don't know.
But in relation to this gentleman's question over here, as far as the essence, you know, maybe the soul of surfing, I think basically, you know, even though our equipment wasn't all that good, but it got better, and we were able to take advantage of that, that it's still a transcendental thing when you take off on a wave and you may have a good ride, you know. it's the same thing that surfers are experiencing nowadays. It's just that the way that they express their enjoyment of that moment might be a little bit different, but in our hearts and souls as surfers, I think it's all the same.
If you remember in the film there, when Peter was interviewing Ricky when he was young, he really articulated well what surfing was all about and what it really meant to him. And then the clip in the beginning where we saw Ricky recently, he still had that smile on his face and he still had that stoke in his look in his eye, and he took it right to the very end.
Ricky loved, loved surfing, and he loved the ocean, and he loved his work, and I think that he was so accomplished in his job. I think that's, you know, we can talk about his surfing, but really, the one thing that made him a Renaissance man was what he did in his work and his creativity, his innovation in his profession, and I think that's what really made Ricky. What I really admire in Ricky was what he did, and then he also was very successful. And it's bringing up families. He had lots of families. Bud Brown was a very quiet, reserved person and a classic. I mean, I have to tell you about Bud Brown. My favorite Bud Brown story is before John Weiser and I got involved with him and got him to realize that he was not the most dynamic, charismatic speaker there was, that he should do a soundtrack. And that's what Cavalcade was of Surf was the second film he had with a soundtrack. But Bud used to do these films all by himself, and he had the music going on a record player. He had his a projector back there in the middle aisle. He'd get up there to do his narration. The film would come off the projector and roll on the aisle. He'd have to run down, get the film, load the film back up. He'd have to run back up to the stage. And in those days, the surfers were just as rude as you could be. They were booing and throwing firecrackers. And, I mean, it was just unbelievable. And here was Bud just persevering through all of this. And he was a classic guy. He was a real good swimmer in his days. He was captain of the USC swim team. He coached at LA City College. In fact, he coached a bunch of guys that were on the same club team that I was on in those days. And I knew Bud through swimming before I ever got involved knowing him about surfing. But he was a great guy and a great individual. And there are some really fantastic people in the world of surfing that I've grown up with. And a lot of the guys in my group, like from Santa Monica, they're not around anymore. It makes me very sad to think about it. And just before Ricky went, Matt Kivlin went, and before that was Kid Horn, my brother Corny, and a whole bunch of people that I grew up with and surfed with at Santa Monica, and then Ricky comes along. But it was really nice to see Ricky. The last day, Bob Lundy and I went in on Sunday to see him, and he was just really positive, and he was really bright. He was really articulate. He wasn't missing a thing, and it was really fun. And it was not just good for Ricky that we went in there. It was really good for Bob and I. We were both so happy that we got to see Ricky before he left us, and I give Ricky a bad time. I'm still giving him a bad time, but I really had a tremendous respect for him, and he was a very, very close friend. He was like a brother to me.
Bud Brown, he ate one time a day, and it was heavy. It was like, you know, like speeding up a film. It was really funny, you know. But I want to say that us local guys and the guys from the mainland, we all ended up getting along with each other, and we all became fast friends, and that is aloha.
What do you think, Peter? Is that good to, when you see these old movies of Buzz, you know, it might have been a year or two or three that you've seen them. Isn't that great to see people like Pete Peterson?
Oh, yeah. Pete Peterson was another Santa Monica guy. There were a lot of guys grew up in Santa Monica. We had some really good people. We had, but Pete Peterson was the number one everything. He was, he could do anything in the ocean. He could free dive, he could, he got more lobster and abs than anybody. He was a great swimmer, great paddler. He won all the paddling races. He was winning all the surf contests back in the 30s and so forth. But he was a great guy, and he talked kind of like this. The whole thing to it, and we used to imitate him. And John Weiser and I would imitate him, you know, and we'd go, the whole thing to it, Nate. And I heard this. I don't think it's a bit funny, you know. And he'd come by the tower, lifeguard tower, and he'd go, you know, he'd do this, Pete came by just before he passed away. He passed away, he had a heart attack or something in his boat after a real strenuous day trying to do lifting of all this stuff and working really hard. He was 60, I think he was almost 70 at the time, or he was in his early 70s. But he was over at our, and he stayed with us out in Sunset Beach, and he had up these charts of this Coos Bay area and all these places in Oregon, he said, where the surf would be really big and stuff when he'd take his boat out there. And it was so nice to be with Pete, and he was a great guy. And you wouldn't, it's such a pleasure to grow up with these guys that were older than me and were my mentors that I idolized. And Pete was one of them, Kivlin, Buzzy Trent, Dave Rockland, Joe Quigg. I mean, we had a group of guys from the Santa Monica era that were just fantastic people. And unfortunately, there aren't too many of us alive. Joe is still around, and myself, and a few of the younger guys. Baby Dave is here today. But that was a wonderful group of people, and it makes, like Kimo says, it's total aloha.
Bud Brown was the sort of grandfather of filmmaking, and he inspired Bruce Brown, Greg McGilvery, and on and on and on. And way back in the days when the surf movies were happening, they used to show them at Roosevelt High School, sometimes at Punahou during the carnival, and Bud Brown would come down, and I started passing out posters when I was 13 years old, and I got to know Bud pretty well. And then Greg McGilvery, who grew up McGilvery Freeman, hired him to do part of the movies up through Five Summer Stories. So I got to work with Bud on the North Shore, and as Kimo said, he was really quiet, and I believe he was a vegetarian, and he would eat once a day. And if you're a vegetarian, if you ate, like you said, it would get you going, and it would allow him to stay on the water all day long. So Bud was an incredible waterman, very quiet guy, but probably worked right through into the 70s till the surf films gave way to the surf video. So he was prolific right to the end.
Yeah, Bud was a sometime tenant at my mom's house. She had an old army barracks that she bought in 1961 for $15,000 out there on the North Shore beachfront, which would be kind of hard to do nowadays. Bud and Bruce Brown both, but I very much admired Bud and enjoyed talking with him, and he, you know, like a lot of older guys go, hey, you know, this kid, you know, he's got an ear, you know, he's willing to listen, he's not shooting his mouth off too much, so, hey, you know, might as well, you know, tell him some of the little stuff.
The Holly the Theater. Oh, that was a classic place. That was great. We used to watch the samurai movies on Wednesday nights or something. And then we'd go to the Clint Eastwood movies, you know, those Italian Clint Eastwood movies, and we used to count the number of people that got killed, you know. I think there was about 432 or something like that. Yeah, but that Hollywood Theater was a classic old theater. In fact, Hollywood changed a lot over the years, but it was beautiful in those days.
I was a fireman. Then the boss would say, how'd you guys do? We saved the real estate, boss.
Yeah, I heard about Kimo having some specific ideas. It might have been better to fight a fire, but some of the guys from the city, you know, there's some of the other chiefs, they have different ideas, and so there was a little bit of headbutting. But this is what happens when a town gets bigger and different philosophies come into play, and there's not always a sense of, you know, logic or realism, you know, and then pretty soon, you know, attitudes come in there and politics starts to play, and then all hell breaks loose, huh, guys?
They call that bureaucracy.
As I said, I used to do surf movies back in the 60s and 70s, and then Honolulu was always a great venue to show a surf film at, because the crowd, especially back in sort of the hippie days, would come up, so these long-haired guys would be coming up, and they'd be offering you these funny cigarettes instead of paying for a ticket, and as soon as the film would start, surf movies were big. As Peter said, I think Wednesday night was samurai night, Thursday night was Filipino night, I think Tuesday night was the porno nights, and so every once in a while a surf movie would come, and it was a big deal out on the North Shore because we didn't have TV back then. There was no TV, so by the time it got dark, it just stopped on the North Shore. So a surf movie came into town, all the surfers would come out of the woodwork, and you'd see guys you've never seen even in the water. And as soon as we start the film, you hear the beer bottles rolling down the aisles and this big blue smoke going up.
Randy's talking about passing out the posters. When he was passing out the posters, John Weiser and I were putting on this surf carnival at the Waikiki Shell, trying to make extra money. One time they had a hypnotist, and this hypnotist was just taking all this time, and people were in the back of the audience, back in the on the back lawn and everything, that weren't close to where the hypnotist was, were screaming, and it looked like we were going to have a total riot, you know, because when surfers go to a surf film, they want to see a surf film, they don't want to hear this magician or this hypnotist talk about stuff. So I'm sitting back there by the, I was sort of handling the booths back in the near the fence, and I'm sitting there watching this, and so I go up to the stage, and John Weiser, who was supposed to be handling the stage, is hypnotized. So I proceeded to pull the hypnotist off the stage, and his wife said, "You can't do that, these people are hypnotized, you can't pull." And the heck I can't, I pulled him off because we were going to have a riot, you know. And then Curtis E.K. comes out and pulls the, you know, that thing where we had Don Manuki and the wrestler, and he was a Stanford football player, banged the board in the beginning of Cavalcade of Surf Book. We had Curtis E.K. doing that at the Waikiki Shell, you know. And he comes out, and finally we got the movie going, and boy, that was really scary because I thought that was going to be the whole riot of the whole thing.
Surf story that you can tell about Ricky?
When he was a junior at Stanford, I heard this from the girl that he took down to the steam lane. He had this pretty girl he said, "You gotta go surfing with me," you know, and so Ricky took this girl down the steamer lane to check the surf, and it happened to be flat that day, but Ricky always showed off. He was bouncing around on the cliffs up there at Steamer Lane. He was doing somersaults and showing off to this girl, and kind of hopping along the cliff. And the girl was watching him. And the girl, when she came up to tell me this, said, "Your friend is crazy." Well, he's bouncing around and bouncing around, and all of a sudden he bounces off the cliff. And he's going like this. He's waving and smiling to the girl as he goes down. He broke his leg. He was in a cast for 2 months. And I tell you, there are lots of stories about Ricky, but this was my favorite because, you know, I could just picture Ricky doing that, you know.
Yeah, Ricky was also a very good diver, and I believe he was in on the initial stages of black coral exploration and selling here in Hawaii, along with when Jose and Bloomfield brothers and the whole raft of people from Maui and Oahu.
Well, Ricky was the precious coral expert, probably worldwide. Yeah, Randy?
You know, as Peter said, there's a zillion stories about Ricky we could tell because we've all known him so long. And I would just, not so much a funny story, but just want to say that Ricky was the only guy that every time he came to the North Shore, told me the North Shore was good. And even when it was blowing out north, when he goes, oh, it's still pretty good.
I just, when I was in the Punahou Bahamas, this is sort of off track, but I always enjoyed this. We didn't have the web, we didn't have all this stuff to know what the surf is going to be, you know? So I would call Klaus Meyer and I'd take his height that he would give me on the phone and divide by three and two. And I would call, and one time I called Buffalo at Army Beach. He was working the Army Beach in Honolulu, and I called Buffalo and Buffalo said, oh, it's really good out here, it's really good. It's about 6 to 8, you'll love it. And she'd come on out, and I get in the car and I drive out and splatter in the lake. And I said, Buffalo, what's the deal? He said, well, I was lonely. We never called Buffalo for the surf report. But, and my favorite was to call Colleen Harlow, and she said, well, you know, I don't know how many feet it is. And I go, well, how many refrigerators is it? And she said, well, that's probably 2 or 3 refrigerators, and I knew how high a refrigerator was. And it was amazing. Her estimates were by far the most accurate.
I went to Punahou School. I was on a scholarship a little bit, but because I didn't fulfill what they wanted me to do, they always says, you went to Punahou School and you're just a fireman. What did you do? Go to school to eat lunch? And you know what? That's true. Because they had me working in the kids' cafeteria. And then they put me with the teacher's cafeteria, and it was just like I was in heaven. And I ate so much that I couldn't go to the class for the next period.
Yeah, it was great when Ricky won the second Duke contest when Duke was still alive, and we had, you know, the influence of Duke as a progenitor of surfing in Hawaii, you know, when Hawaii was enjoying its resurgence from, shall we say, the dark ages, when it was kind of a kapu activity, and Duke was at the forefront of bringing surfing back. So when Ricky won the contest and Jeff Hackman the year before him, and I got to, through Jeff's recommendation, and I think partly Kimo's, to be a water patrol in the first Duke contest, and I got to meet Duke personally, shake his hand, and Dookie's hands were so big that your hand would disappear up to the wrist, you know. Dookie was a great guy in his era, and Ricky was a great guy in his era, and we're looking forward to continuing that with the help of gentlemen like this and this here.
I guess.
I just wanted to know if you and Kimo still serve. I know Josh and Ben.
I don't surf. I had shoulder problems about 5 years ago, and I when I went out, I was such a kook. I just thought it's not safe out here with neon. So. But I surfed until I was 75, 76. So I think Kimo still surfs.
Yeah, I still surf, but small waves.
That's not entirely true. If you consider, you know, double overhead small, then that's your point.
I can attest to, it's a good thing Peter stopped surfing because he ran over to me at sunset.
Yeah. I doggone Randy cut my way. You know, he doesn't seem to understand that the guy paddling out does not have the right of way. The guy riding the wave has the right of way. And I ran into him, but I did feel real bad because I wiped him out so badly he couldn't surf for about a month. So both Sally and I took he and Jackie out for dinner to make up for that.
first and foremost, Randy, congratulations on the Hall of Fame. Doc, you're still my hero to this day, and all of you gentlemen, thank you so much for keeping serving, serving.
Well, it looks like we're all ready to probably call it a night. It's been a long night. I noticed that people have had to leave because it was getting past their bedtime. It's past my bedtime. It's past Kimo's bedtime. I don't know about Jack. These young guys stay up later than we do. And thank you so much. And I just want to say it's been a really awesome.